Today I would like to continue our journey into the book of Psalms, and I think that you'll agree when you read this specific psalm this morning, I think it sounds like it probably could have been written yesterday. The images there are timeless, the content is contemporary, and last week we looked at what we classify as a psalm of individual lament. This week, we will look at what is classified as a psalm of national lament. And I'd like to begin with this question. Do you think that the United States of America is lamenting our cultural and religious landscape of the 21st century? Back in the 1950s, which some of you may remember parts of the 50s, according to statistics, if you would ask Americans if what religion they follow, who you identify with, 95% of Americans claimed to be Christians in the 1950s. In the second decade of the 21st century here, that number is down to 70%. And that's just ones that claim to be Christians. I don't have to tell you that identifying as a Christian and actually having saving faith in Jesus are two completely separate things. It's very similar to the popular thing nowadays is that people want to say they identify as something that they are not. That way everyone stands up and applauds their bravery and courage. But as a nation, it's pretty clear that we've fallen off a long way in a short period of time. And to top it off, in this century, the words, "America is not a Christian nation," were once declared from the nation's highest office. If we aren't lamenting, I think we should be. And more so, we should be repenting as well as a nation. If we think that we aren't deserving of punishment for the things that we've done, both individually and nationally, then I think we're fooling ourselves. When God punishes people, it's not because he is a mean person, a mean God up there in heaven. The purpose is to rehabilitate people, to change the way that they are acting. What we'll do is take a quick trip back to about 1000 BC. And this is where King David was ruling over Israel. Because of several bad things that he did, God declared that there would be strife in his family. Within just a couple of generations afterwards, the fighting in David's family had spread to a national level, and Israel split, creating two nations. The nation of Judah was an offshoot of that, and then Israel remained a tiny portion of what it was. Each of these nations had its own king, and history shows us that Israel had mostly the evil ones. Judah's not a whole lot better. In the year 722 BC, Israel fell to the Assyrian Empire. And for the nation of Judah who remained, at least they had a few good kings mixed in with the bad ones. That allowed them to survive a little bit longer. The prophet Isaiah foretold 100 years prior that they would be defeated and taken into exile. And that prophecy was fulfilled in the year 586 BC. When Judah was overtaken by King Nebuchadnezzar, the Babylonian Empire. Now remember, all of this I'm mentioning is a result of David's initial sin. That shows us how devastating and far-reaching the effects of one man can have on individuals and entire nations. And it's in the context of the nation of Judah being taken captive by the Babylonians that Psalm 74 was written. When the Babylonians invaded Judah, they did what people do in war. They left a path of destruction, and specifically, they targeted the temple because they knew that's where the people worshipped, and if they could destroy that, they thought they could completely demoralize these individuals. With that as the background, if you're following in your pew Bibles, you'll find our passage this morning on page 415. and we'll read in Psalm 74 the first 12 verses. The word of the Lord says, "Why have you rejected us forever, O God? Why does your anger smolder against the sheep of your pasture? Remember the people you purchased of old, the tribe of your inheritance whom you redeemed, Mount Zion where you dwell. Turn your steps toward these everlasting ruins, all this destruction the enemy has brought on the sanctuary. Your foes roared in the place where you met with us. They set up their standards as signs. They behaved like men wielding axes to cut through a thicket of trees. They smashed all the carved paneling with their axes and hatchets. They burned your sanctuary to the ground. They defiled the dwelling place of your name. They said in their hearts, 'We will crush them completely.' They burned every place where God was worshipped in the land. We are given no miraculous signs. No prophets are left, and none of us knows how long this will be. How long will the enemy mock you, O God? Will the foe revile your name forever? Why do you hold back your hand, your right hand? Take it from the folds of your garment and destroy them. But you, O God, are my king from old, from of old. You bring salvation upon the earth." May the Lord's blessing be added to the reading and hearing of his holy word. Of course, the song goes on a little more, but it's more of the same there. We can tell from the words that the times were desperate for these people. They've been relocated out of their homeland against their will. They've seen their holy temple destroyed, and they have no idea how or when they're going to get back the land that God had promised them. We see through this saga, God is willing to punish his people in ways that give them incentive to return to them stronger than they were before, allowing Israel to be taken captive by the Assyrians, and then allowing the people of Judah to be taken captive by the Babylonians. That's punishment for their willingness to follow pagan practices despite all the warnings from the prophets. This illustrates to us that God's ways don't always make sense to us, because we may think, okay, God, yeah, these people did wrong. They did some things they weren't supposed to, but don't you think the punishment is a little too harsh for the crime? They did what people do nowadays. These people were thinking, my religion is a personal issue, so I'm not hurting anyone by bowing down to this God here or worshiping that God over there. To God, it's not personal. To God, your worship or lack of worship is one of the most important things there is. As far as the punishment not fitting the crime, God knew exactly what he was doing when he allowed them to be taken captive. From a human perspective, it seemed like the solution to the problem was worse than the problem itself. Sort of reminds me of the college football scandal you may vaguely remember 30-some years ago. 1987, it involved Southern Methodist University. Long story short, college athletes not allowed to receive money for their playing and their services doesn't stop some schools from trying to twist and bend the rules. And that happened at Southern Methodist. They were a small program, wanted to become a large program, play with the big boys. So they started twisting and bending the rules, giving a little cash on the side here and benefits over there. After several times of being called out on this and being punished here, punished there, the first and only time in history of college football, they were handed what they call the death penalty, which means that their whole pro football program was completely shut down. Now, back to Psalm 74, Babylonian captivity, the Assyrian captivities, that was like God handing down his football death penalty to these people, because they were completely at the mercy of their enemies now. And I don't really like the term death penalty in terms of the sports program, because it sounds like it's the end of the road. I mean, once you're dead, you stay dead typically. But that's not what it is. The The purpose is to completely shut down the program and in a few years bring it back to life and, you know, much better than what it was. When God punishes his people, it's also not punitive in nature, as he is gracious enough not to completely destroy these people. If he wanted to, he could have, just like he did with the people of Sodom and Gomorrah many, many years before that. Now, it is human nature that oftentimes it's a lot easier for us to see how others offend God than when we do it ourselves. And in Psalm 74, we get some details about the destruction of the temple of worship. They say there were pagans wielding axes. They were using hammers. They were setting fire to the house of God. Just imagine if a group of vigilantes burst into this church on a Sunday morning doing the same thing. We would be helpless to stand by and stop it as they chop into the picture of Jesus here behind me, you know, take hammers to the pulpit, smash out the stained glass windows, and set fire to the pews. That would, I think, many of us, myself included, would be moved to tears to see something like that. Now, if you take one thing from this message this morning, I hope that it's this. Those, back in Psalm 74, the ones we're talking about, who witnessed the destruction of the temple, they could see how terrible these things were that the pagans were doing, but they never recognized their own sin leading up to that point. What I mean is, like I said earlier, the prophet Isaiah, more than 100 years prior, had warned them what was going to happen. And over 100 years, they were destroying the temple themselves. Maybe not literally, but in a spiritual manner, they were doing so. They were involved in all sorts of pagan practices in God's own holy temple. Sort of like on a Sunday morning, if I tell you all, okay, next Sunday, let's bring in some Ouija boards into the sanctuary. We're going to set up an idol right as you come in. We'll bow down to it and worship it. And we wouldn't literally be destroying the building, but we would be destroying the purity and sanctity for which it stands. These people couldn't see their own destruction of the temple, but they certainly could see the literal destruction by their enemies. And that's how it often is. We oftentimes can see the faults of other people as clear as day, but blind to our own sinfulness. Now, last point this morning is take notice that the writer of this psalm never questions God throughout everything that happens. He asks some questions of God, which is completely fine to do, because they all deal with God's future plans, not what God has already done. See, God's judgment is perfect, and we don't need to question him about things that had happened. Now, some people have called it God's judgment on the United States, number of other things. I'm sure we all remember September 11, 2001. That was when 3,000 plus New Yorkers lost their lives in the terrorist attacks. The interesting thing is, the following Sunday, September 16th, on average, there were a lot more people at church than there were the prior week on September 9th. But how long did that last? What typically happens, and happens then, over time, people get complacent with things. Your lives get back to normal, you rebuild. So people who were going to church on September 16th decided, okay, I don't need God anymore. I'll put him up on the shelf. When people reject God, and enough people do it, you have a nation that has collectively rejected God. Just a lot of problems in the world, in the United States alone. I don't even have time this morning to get into. We know what they all are, so it only would color in the picture a little more. But the fact is, I think that we, in the 21st century, are collectively a lot more like the Old Testament people that God had judged than maybe we want to admit. And we see what happened to those people. Just like the people of Israel and Judah, do we make compromises of faith here and there just out of convenience? Some people nowadays, they don't want to be seen as traditional fuddy-duds. So, you know, if I follow the Bible as is written, well, people want that updated to the 21st century because we don't live like that anymore. Well, God's moral code never changes. And if that makes me a traditional fuddy-dud, then I wear that label proudly. People expect God to save them when they want to be saved. And the same was for the people in the Old Testament in Psalm 74. When you start expecting grace from God, that is a form of injustice. And injustice is not in the character of God. And I think that's why the writer of the Psalm never questions God's judgment. He knows that God's justice is holy, righteous, and perfect. And that's what it is. This psalm is a cry out to God to be holy, righteous, and perfect. And the writer knew that in spite of any wrongs that any human being does, if you are one of God's elect, then you know you are guaranteed victory because of your relationship with God. But it still doesn't give us a pass to act in any kind of ungodly way. And just think, those in the Old Testament were confident that God would save them because there was this covenant made with Abraham many, many years before. They thought, well, we're the chosen people, so we sort of have an in with God, and I can therefore do whatever I want. God showed them in a big way, no, you can't. So if God chooses to judge anyone, it's because he's holy and righteous, and he has the authority to judge. But no matter what happens, whether we travel farther down this road of national sin, or if we experience a great revival like never seen before, we are always each individually responsible for our own actions, and it only takes one person to start a revival. So I want to leave you thinking about the character of God, because the way that God interacts and relates to us is completely determined by his holy character. The writer of the psalm is concerned that God's punishment is going to last forever. We need to remember one of the most important aspects of God's character is his grace. Grace is never warranted, which is why when God dispenses grace, we should appreciate it all the more. Whether we receive it on a national level or individually. Grace comes after we have been rehabilitated, though, and God sees that we are changing from our evil ways. And then he removes our sin from us as far as the east is from the west. The Lord's Supper that we will be partaking of shortly is a reminder to us of God's infinite grace that he dispensed through the life and death and resurrection of his son, Jesus Christ. Let us bow our heads and pray at this time.